Hello everyone, my name is Nazar Babik. I'm working in Viking Software Company, and today we are going to talk about practical usage of CAN bus from Qt. But before we'll start, I would like you to remind about our small competition. So if you want to win this tiny drone that comes with C++ API, just put your business card to that box, or if you don't have your business card, we have empty cards and write up your contact details. And at the end of this talk, Bo Thorsen will select the winner. So this is agenda for today. Me, CAN bus overview, hardware, software, and application. Let's start from me. I've been working on commercial projects since 2005. Every project were written using C++. They were as front-end as back-end. In 2010, I found Qt for myself when I was looking for nice UI framework that could be used with C++ for my own project. 2016, I joined it to the Viking Software Company, and I have hobby, it's automotive things like reverse engineering of engine control units and ability to adjust some parameters data. Also, I played with my car cluster to output some useful information on it, and when Qt released the CAN bus support, I decided to make this presentation. Now, let's take a look at CAN bus. It's with the overview. CAN is a multi-master serial bus standard that used to connect devices to CAN network. You need to have at least two devices to connect and to make it work. They are connected by two signals wires. It's CAN high and CAN low. Transmission speed is up to 1 megabit for CAN or more for CANFD or flexible data rate. It's message-based protocol. All messages are called frames. Every frame has several fields important for us. Next, it's identifier, which could be 11 or 29 bits lines, depending on version. It's the frame type. It could be data frame, remote request, or overload, or error. And the payload. For a standard CAN, it's limited to 8 bytes, and for CANFD, it's up to 64. Every frame in CAN network is broadcast to every node, so it's not possible to send some specific frame to some specific node. But every node or device can filter some frames, for example, by identifier. Also, the most important thing is devices that are going to talk to each other should be configured to the same speed in CAN network. Now, let's take a look about our hardware. It's a third generation of Raspberry Pi. It Model B has 1.2 GHz quad-core Broadcom CPU with 1 GB of RAM. And it's pretty fast for Qt and QML. Also, we have a Raspberry touchscreen. And to connect our Raspberry to CAN network, we used CAN bus shield. As light device, we have cluster from BMW. They are connected by three wires. It's two signals, CAN high and CAN low, and ground, as a power cluster has own power source. Now let's move to software. I installed JC operation system. It was latest on that moment, as now they have stretch. To initialize our CAN bus shield, we need to configure boot.txt file and set up some default speed. I did that to 100 kilobits per second, as our cluster works on that speed. JC comes with outdated Qt version, is 5.3.2, which doesn't have support of CAN bus. The same as stretch that comes with 5.6. As serial bus was introduced only in 5.8 version. So if you want to use it, you need to have at least that version. I used 5.9.1 because it was also latest on that moment. Now they have new one. If you are going to make some cross-compilation, you need to have also Raspberry Pi. So let's start from software part. As we are going to develop for our embedded device, I used to make compilation version, cross-compilation version, to make my life easier and to have ability to build, debug, and deploy all executables directly on Raspberry sitting on my host PC. How to do that depends on what operation system is installed on your host. There are a lot of information over internet. So after you did the build, you need to synchronize Qt build output to your Raspberry Pi. And we are ready to start the customization of Qt Creator to have ability to build, debug, and deploy. For do that, we only need to select proper compiler, debugger, and add our target device in device list. After that, you can do whatever you want directly on Raspberry Pi from your host PC. Now let's move. When our software is almost ready, we can start application development. First of all, we need to include the serial bus model to our project to include headers and libraries that contain scan bus. Qt offers a few main classes. First of them is QCAN bus. It handles CAN plugins, enumerate devices, and ability to create device to work. All bus plugins work with different CAN devices, probably they are not many, but we are interested in a socket CAN, with which it encapsulates a Linux socket API to work with. Next one is QCAN device info. Its class provides short information about device, like name, flexible data rate flag, and information if device is virtual. Next one is QCAN bus device. It provides API to work with CAN bus plugin and scan our device. It's a main class. It allows us to connect, disconnect, send, receive data, and receive signals. For example, about incoming frames or for about errors. Next one is QCAN bus frame. It's a container representing a single CAN frame. It has several fields. One of them is frame type. As we are going only to send data packet, we can specify it to data frame. And if we would like to get some information back from device, we can use a remote request frame. When a device receives such frame, it understands that we are going to receive some information back, and payload size tells him how many size need to send back. Now let's move to our application. It's very simple, few buttons and gouges. It was written using QML with C++. Why QML? Because it has nice gouges. So let's start. First of all, we need to create our device. We can use QCAN bus singleton, pass socket CAN to it as plugin, and name of CAN device. It is CAN 0 in our case. If we have several devices, we can enumerate them using available devices function, also from that QCAN bus class. When creation is done, we can connect interesting signal for us. I have connected two signals, error occurred and frames received, to know when we have some new messages in our network and if there are some errors. After preparation is done, we can connect to our device. When connection is done, we can send and receive some information to our network. Here is some example how to turn on or turn off backlight of clusters. As you see, it's pretty simple. All that you need is to construct a QCAN bus frame with identifier and a payload. In our case, it's 3 bytes. depending what we need to do. And send with a write frame function. To use, this is a very simple case. For example, if we need to move gauges, we need to activate that cluster because it won't work without that. There is some special frames that need to be sent to tell cluster that we are ready to drive and we want to do something useful. When cluster is activated, we can move some gauges. This is some screen with them. All that components has mouse area over control to detect touches and to understand what value should be sent to cluster. Also, when application cluster is activated, it starts sending a lot of messages to CAN network to understand what devices are near him and to get values from them. Interesting. Here I have some video demonstration how it works. It's connecting. Nothing. Now we can turn on backlights. Was using previous. Let's toggle it off. And now cluster activation. As you can see, here is a lot of lights. Most of them are error lights because no more systems are connected. And you can see messages in CAN network. They come from cluster. And we are moving to our gauges. So, yeah. Now, deactivating it and turning off. So, as you can see, it's pretty simple, and you can use such visual effects if you need to synchronize, need to show that some background operation is in progress. For example, when you need to synchronize some data, it could be useful for devices that doesn't have displays, and but need to tell that something is going on. Also, you can use any other lights, for example, side lights on cluster for navigation, or this one example is for communication with cluster. But also, you can grab all frames with useful information, collect them, and for example, build some graphs for trip. You can do what you want with that data. I didn't explain about Pilot because they are very individual for car brand and even for car model. So if you need to get how it works on probably your car, you need to get dump of frames, analyze them, and you're ready to work. Because such information is not very published and need to dig something. That's probably everything. Maybe any questions? Yes.
Is there a community for reverse engineering the CAN? The signals you said it's not published, but is there some kind of community?
For that BMW cluster, yes, there is some site, but there is not whole information, but need to dig more. But yes, there are some resources with enthusiasts who also did that before. But messages are pretty different for every, even for every model. So we need to see for what device you are going to send. Something else? Yes? That rate, transmission speed, do you mean? It's 100 kilobits per second. That data for revolution and speed was sent with 100 milliseconds interval, so 10 times per second to make a move smoother. Yes, you need to pull every time. For example, with backlights, just turn on or turn off, but for such critical data, you need to sent very often. Maybe something else? Yes.
Have you investigated on receiving messages from the
canvas? Yes, you can see on this slide, on the video. After your cluster activation, what you can see here, this message, it's messages from CAN cluster, from cluster into CAN network. First is identifier, then length and payload.
Because usually nodes which are sending messages on the canvas, they are sending messages about the process data unit and so on.
If you have
usually a master needs to receive many messages and process them.
Yes, if you, for example, if you have some sensor, you can send a remote request to it, and when it receives such a frame, it sends data back, like here. But depends on device. Sometimes you need to pull, sometimes you need to send request, sometimes just data, and it pulls. So it depends. Something else question? Yes.
On the slide we made the canvas connection, specified socket 10 and 0. Can you explain to me what socket 10 means in that process?
Yes, I did that before, probably you missed. Socket 10, it's the name of plugin. That plugin is encapsulating Linux socket API to work with CAN device, and CAN zero, it's name of our device connected. As we have only one device connected, I just pull that name. Yes. It was introduced in the 5.8 version, CAN bus, in a serial bus module, also with Modbus. So they are two classes to work with such hardware. Yes?
In that module, it's 35
in terms of ISO 26,
for example. Can you repeat, please? Is that communication module 35, like what ISO 26, for example?
Why?
You want to use that module, that communication module, inside the cluster, communicate inside the module with the other module?
I don't remember which one, but that CAN shield has. I don't remember exactly what names, but yes. Probably, can you rephrase because it's not well heard here? Okay, maybe later.
If it is, it can be in the documentation. Okay.
So, no questions? Okay, and probably we can finish our competition. Let me call Bo.
Yes, 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 yes.